Hi, I'm George, last year's Patrol of the Year, and I'm here with this year's Patrol of the Year, Ben. And we're going to show you a smart new addition to our multi-fit wheel kit, the freewheeling hub. This will allow us to recover four-wheel drives and electric vehicles with our vans. Currently, we fix 8 out of 10 vehicles at the side of the road, so we only recover them when we absolutely have to. But with limited space on the busy roads, we need to get these customers away quickly and safely.
What we're finding now, 1 in 5 of our breakdowns are actually 4x4s and heavier vehicles, and with the zero emission targets we're trying to achieve in the UK, there's a big increase in electric vehicles on the road as well.
Alternative recovery of these vehicles can take up to 90 minutes. So let's see how much quicker and simpler it is when we're using the freewheeling hub. We've got 90 minutes to beat. Let's see how much time we can save. Are you ready, Ben?
I'm ready, George. Start the clock.
While Ben's working on the first wheel, let's take a look at how the freewheeling hub works in a little more detail.
Manufacturers don't recommend towing electric vehicles because you can't put them in neutral. The freewheeling hub is the latest addition to our multi-fit wheel kit that takes that problem away. Once the car is loaded onto the van, it's just 4 simple steps to fit. Step 1, remove the rear wheel. Step 2, put on the multi-fit hub. This lets us fit a temporary spare wheel to almost any vehicle. Step 3, place on the new freewheeling hub. This has its own heavy-duty, high-speed bearing, making it turn independently from the car itself. Step 4, fit the temporary spare multi-fit wheel. Then do the same on the other side. Let's see how Ben's getting on.
How often use this kit then, Ben?
Well, a shift last week, I actually used it 3 times.
So is there a weight limit?
There actually is, it's 2 tonnes. It's the towing capabilities of our vans.
So what happens when you get to the garage or main dealer where you towed the customer to?
When we arrive at the garage, we've got to remove the wheel and the hub, because by fitting them, what we've done, we've isolated the handbrake system. So when we're unloading it from our recovery equipment, or CRT, it could potentially roll away, especially if we're on a hill. So once we've removed it, we've put the original wheels back on. We make sure the member's happy with the garage and everything's being sorted out for them. Load everything back up in the van and away we go to the next job.
Great. So how are you doing with that second wheel?
Job done.
Right, stop the clock. How did we do?
Not bad really, 15 minutes in total.
Now we can safely tow the vehicle away on 2 wheels ourselves.
So we can get the cars off the roadside quicker, our customers can get on with their day, and we can get off and help more people. No damage to the car when towing, no need to call in the cavalry, and no need to leave anybody waiting around.
Hello and welcome to Fleet Live. It's my pleasure to present on behalf of Fleet News the approach adopted by Gateshead Transport Function in response to the COVID crisis. My presentation will consider where we started from, our current position, and the future operating with COVID from a transport viewpoint. We will discuss transport engineering, driver deployment, and service provision. Flood and emergency planning. Councils are required to have in place plans to address major incidents such as unforeseen occurrences, i.e. crashes, fire, multiple accidents, flood, terror incidents, where there's danger to life and property. To ensure continuity, the operation is a multi-agency approach. To respond, we must have contingencies such as emergency and temporary accommodation for residents, utilising sports centres, civic halls and other suitable venues. When evacuating residents, we must have provision for adequate transport to ensure people are moved out of risk zones efficiently. To facilitate this, we would utilise in-house transport minibuses, welfare coaches, and local transport providers, such as taxi operators and companies. Food and other amenities are an additional requirement provided by both business and the voluntary sector, as they all need a transport requirement. These plans and scenarios are tested on a regular basis. However, all of the above has an end date, which is generally within 48 hours, leading to a long-term solution being introduced. And it's from this basis we have developed the experience and resource to address various scenarios. However, all the best laid plans are open to test, and I can safely say that no one expected a pandemic of this nature to have such longevity. The flu epidemics of the past have been controlled by viral drugs for the most vulnerable members of society. Therefore, the NHS would take priority on protecting the health of the nation as we went forward. And it's from this background we started out addressing COVID pandemic. The government was quick to ensure continuity of some aspects of society, and speaking from a local authority point of view, these services as followed. Introducing a national breakdown, this would have major impact on the police, public utilities, electric waste, food supply, social care, postal deliveries and waste, recycling, highways, along with the plethora of other activities. With this in mind, the government quickly acknowledged the need for key workers to ensure a continuity of services. Therefore, I question if there ever was a national lockdown. Regarding Gateshead Borough, Gateshead is located on the southern bank of the River Tyne, opposite Newcastle to the north and County Durham to the south. And Gateshead covers over a 55 square mile radius. The population is approximately 200,000 with 91,000 households, in addition to a wide spectrum of businesses spread throughout the borough. As lockdown was implemented, transport services were asked to continue to provide various frontline services, such as RCV collections, including trade waste, were in addition to new transport demands emerging as a consequence of the pandemic. This included the provision of vast amount of PPE to various organisations, i.e. public health workers and key workers. Also providing school meals and transport for children who were attending school whilst parents were employed as key workers. We also continued to supply a vast amount of food via the food bank programme. Housing stock repair provision needed to be maintained for emergency repairs. Delaying or limiting waste and recycling services was not an option, as this would result in additional adverse environmental impacts. Care Corp and Dane residential care homes also required a 24-hour transport service. Therefore, it was essential to maintain staffing provision to address these requirements. Another significant factor was the reduction of traffic flow. Vehicle volume dropped significantly during the lockdown, which had a major impact on vehicle emissions. And as this graph illustrates, the change in the traffic flow from a baseline, at one stage it was 60% below the 18th of March prior to the lockdown. This traffic flow reduction resulted in lower emissions in formerly high traffic areas. Therefore, some local authorities are reappraising their clean air zone commitments. Regarding the national picture on waste services, huge fluctuations in volumes of and makeup of waste was also experienced. Tonnage of recycling and household waste rose due to people self-isolating, working from home and furloughing. In mid-April, councils were reporting up to a 50% increase in household waste and recycling caused by decluttering homes. Almost half councils were reporting up to a 100% decrease in commercial waste due to the closure of offices, pubs and restaurants. However, after phase one of lockdown easing, this resulted in commercial waste going back up to previous levels, but household waste remained high. And the challenges to our service provision. Our primary concern at lockdown was to ensure key workers could continue to work safely in order that services could still be delivered. We have one centralised depot for maintenance, but to maintain safe distance, we work with a 50% reduction in staff, working 1 week on and 1 week off. This was to prevent the scope of 8 to 9 operatives being off work self-isolating. We could not afford to have this entire team off work, as it would severely impact our capacity to mend vehicles and provide an essential service. It was important to continue with routine maintenance of vehicles and keep MOTing vehicles despite DVSA extensions. This was to ensure that coming out of the other end of COVID, we would not have part of the fleet due for MOT in service. This has been challenging, especially when outside providers who may have closed or furloughed staff are relied upon for lower examinations and workshop equipment calibrations. Keeping up to date with information from the Department of Transport and Logistics UK has been an essential tool. Driver for Better Business has also offered sound advice on a regular basis. Mobile tradesmen, however, who start working from home were furloughed, and this led to problems retrieving vehicles to off hire, as all drivers have sufficient tools and equipment to carry out necessary work across the working week. To enable vehicles to be off hired, we needed to find additional storage space for the tools and equipment removed until they return to work. Also obtaining additional keys to get access to vehicles that were parked at operators' homes who had been self-isolated was also a further challenge. The cost of end hire repairs would be prohibitive, as these vehicles, which were not scheduled for return, often needed remedial work, and this would have been offset against the savings. It was essential to maintain a robust supply chain by regular contact with our parts supply providers. Additional equipment for home working, i.e. computer chairs and computer equipment, iPads and such like, and iPhones, were distributed to various members of staff. That was also a challenge to get that equipment back out to people's homes so they could work effectively. Staff morale is maintained by toolbox talks and access to mental health officers. And some of the challenges that were carried out were as follows during the lockdown period on some of our vehicles. Street scene have up to 35 26 ton refuse vehicles in use, and this has been a real challenge operating them on a daily basis due to the fact they usually run with crews of up to 3 people in a single cab. We initially to put together a support fleet with team members following the RCV vehicle in separate vans. They then park up, work that area, and then move on the vans to the next zone. It was clear that this was not sustainable economically. This system alone incurred a further 40 vehicles on hire. Therefore, I decided a triple screen layout to be input into the vehicle to segregate the passengers from the drivers in the vehicle cab. This was done in consultation with the drivers and unions and managers. This was then rolled out across the rest of the large vehicle groups, and coupled with wearing face masks, this has been an effective solution and avoids additional vehicle hire, and which enabled the return of over 40 spot hire vehicles. And this has been so successful, it's been adopted by other operators. And this can be seen on the top left-hand photograph. You can see the curtain screen layout adjacent to the driver and along, separating the two operatives who will sit alongside him. And they, as I said, wear additional face masks also. However, at the end of each shift, the vehicle is deep cleaned and sanitized in readiness for the next day. And an additional vehicle, we were also tasked with providing a vehicle for the NHS mobile testing unit to be used for vulnerable and less mobile residents. The vehicle was modified to ensure both a clean environment and to separate patients from the consultant area. All services required to be easily cleaned and it was necessary to have this vehicle ready to go into service in less than 3 weeks. It also required, as you can see, that's the white van on the right-hand side of the picture, it also needed a cassette wheelchair lift also added, and that was done in a very efficient time using our own in-house team and contractors. Regarding the future, complacency. As we have entered the second phase of COVID, reappraisal of our operation has been essential as complacency has crept into the organisation in some areas. To address this, we have introduced new poster campaigns and updated toolbox talks, which are carried out weekly to ensure social distance and mitigate the spread of the virus. The cost of the pandemic to date within the council is circa £8 million. Independent working has also been considered and implemented where applicable. Home working has been in place for a number of months and itself has long-term implications for staff morale and interaction with other colleagues. Our fleet replacement policy is to be reviewed in the long term due to staff reductions and home working. If operations are being carried out differently, then vehicle requirements will have to be reconsidered. Dedicated teams for vehicle sanitation going forward is also under consideration, and working from localised hubs, therefore reducing close contact between staff. And my final comment is that the way forward in ensuring an effective organisation and to challenge this COVID problem is to share best practice with our partners. Thank you for your time for listening.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm pleased to join this Q&A session with Graham on learnings from COVID-19 and future disaster planning tactics. This session is kindly sponsored by the AA, and we also have Dean Hedger, new business development manager of the AA, with us as well to field the Q&As. So getting started, just a few from me to start off with Graham and Dean. So first one for me, directed at you, Graham. How did COVID-19 help the councils to focus on what was truly essential journeys? So what was that essential trip that you kind of got your guys to say, yep, you can definitely do that under lockdown conditions?
Well, the essential trips were, vehicle-wise, were obviously breakdowns, but the service to the users was predominantly for care call teams, where they were visiting the vulnerable and the people in care homes also, and food for deliveries. And we also had all the RCV collection rounds as well, because that was an environmental impact. So they were the essential users.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Another one from me, just briefly. To what extent will home working reduce the need for vehicles on your fleet?
A lot of the planning teams, they're working from home, and health and safety teams, they're all working from home, and they were predominantly vehicle users as well. So this last 7 months, especially going into the second phase of lockdown, we're reviewing our fleet operations now as to whether we need this strength of fleet or maybe go back to dueling vehicles again so we can spread them out, because some home working is very effective. And obviously with the government promoting this throughout the lockdown period, it's something that we're going to have to seriously review.
And kind of same question for Dean. Based on the AA, your experience, the AA, what have you guys seen in terms of, the reduction in fleet miles versus the home
We've seen them in the first lockdown. We saw quite a reduction in the work rate of almost 50% of road traffic, and during the months coming out of that lockdown period, it kind of crept back up. It's almost crept back up to about sort of 10% every month. We then approached the next lockdown, and we were almost back to kind of pre-COVID levels by then. And we've seen a drop recently of probably not much more than 15 to 20% at this time, because we've still seen, obviously, education remain open, so the very much the school run still running, and a lot of work and employment has still continued. So the roads have remained busier this time, but we have seen a slightly small drop. I think more specifically to fleets, and just, I suppose, personal thoughts on my background was obviously in fleet. I think people need to be looking at operations and have to look very carefully at the use of the vehicles moving forward, because with working from home, there is definitely a reduction in mileage. There'll still be a need for a vehicle, but I think it's very much about the right type of vehicle for the right type of role is probably what we're going to have to start to look at.
I can see a question from the audience as well. So it's a question for Graham from Alison Moriarty. So Graham, how did you manage to get so much done, and what have you learned through this process?
Well, I get so much done, I don't know about that, but being at work throughout the whole of this period, maybe had a couple of days off, and it has been a challenge, but splitting the workforce up to ensure that we had people who were fit throughout the whole of the period was an essential part of being able to meet the demand. And that all of our trucks, all 300 of them, have been out on the road. The light van side, that has been a whole different matter. They've been parked. I would say 75% of those have been parked, but the truck side has worked throughout the whole of this process.
And then Dean, what have you learned as EAA throughout COVID as an organisation?
Well, we've learned that there's a lot of drivers have seen a reduction in emissions. I think we've all seen a reduction in emissions and cleaner air. So there's very much in some of the surveys that we've undertaken a desire to drive less, walk more, cycle more. We're certainly seeing those changes, but you flip that with use of public transport, we're seeing a lot less of that. And the kind of rush hour that we've seen has sort of almost shifted slightly, because people are going in vehicles, not public transport. It's almost shifted sort of slightly later in the day, but we see those peaks of travel. So that's been very different. But we're also seeing a nervousness amongst drivers as people are coming back to the road. Some of the surveys we've undertaken have suggested that, just over 3 million people are more nervous about driving than before. Millennials are more anxious about driving as well. So yeah, we are seeing some changes, as well as, changes we've undertaken to protect our staff and obviously our members in dealing with COVID day to day, screens in recovery trucks and that kind of activity.
Yeah. Cool. And then Graham, shared from a fleet manager perspective, COVID has caused some challenges when it comes to shared vehicle utilisation and usage. So what have you guys been able to do to try and make sure that you keep your employees safe when you're asking them to share vehicles, whether they're vans?
The crews in the large trucks developed, as mentioned in the presentation, put a series of screens in the vehicle. They were curtain type screens, so that they would, in the event of an accident, there wouldn't be any injury. So we modified the interior of the cab so we could mount these mounting brackets and then fit the curtain material in, so we could get the three people in the cab, because we were having issues with, we had to hire an additional 40 vans for crews to follow that around. But each, at the end of each shift, every vehicle sanitized overnight, so we've had to get extra cleaning staff in to do that. All of the vehicles have a sanitizer spray, which you put into the heating system or the aircon, spray that in, empty the can, and then that goes throughout the whole of the vehicle and sanitizes it. So that has been something that's going to have to go on well after the closure of this day, because people will expect it. The people working in close proximity will want some kind of security and knowing that they're sitting alongside someone who they're not gonna catch a cold for you, because people are in a place now, whereas if you get the symptoms, you go off till you have a test. And will this be something that's going on in the future? So how we change now and our attitude to cleanliness is as a nation that's got to change. We've got to be much more acutely aware about personal hygiene.
I think you're right. We put safe systems of work in place that they're not going to disappear overnight. There's not going to be suddenly the day that we say, okay, that's all finished now. We can remove all these protective screens. We can change all the systems that we put in place. There's certainly going to be newly introduced processes that will continue to be normal.
Yeah, I guess then you guys are also, I'm sure, Graham, maybe you're doing the same sort of thing around people working in bubbles as well now. Is that kind of becoming?
Well, a number of years ago, at the beginning of austerity, we closed a lot of buildings that were working in depots to save costs and get rid of some building stock. We're now looking at getting people into different silos and different groups away from large offices, you know, because, and the cheapest way out of that is working from home, you know, because lots of companies are not going to need these huge office spaces they've had in the past, and our civic centre is one of those. But even in the garages, in the main garages here, we're having to open up areas that were formerly storage areas and put mobile hoists in there to get guys separated to ensure that there's adequate social distance, because they're together 8 to 9 hours every day and they have to work closely. It's like a guy's going out on an AA job when they've got to call their colleague in. There's someone that got to work very closely together, and it's minimising that risk. So it's going to be a huge process change going forward. And when people say it will never be the same, you think, oh, that's a bit doomsday view. But really, it's something we can do, and we will have to do it. It's just a new process of how we conduct our lives.
Yeah, I completely get that. And then in terms of, Graham, in terms of your pool fleet, is it still exactly the same size? Are you still managing that in a different way now, I guess?
Yeah, the pool fleet, again, so many people are working from home, and the pool fleet is up for review as to whether we actually need these many vehicles. And again, what I haven't seen is some of the pool vehicles are utilised by the public after hours. Their utilisation of those vehicles haven't materialised the way they were, and particularly with public transport being controlled and people getting back into cars. So I think the people who actually had to come to use a pool car are like a common wheels type of operation have thought, really, do I need to do that journey? You know, do I really need to go? Or instead of going 3 times a week to use it, I just use it once or twice now. So that's changed. I wouldn't say the same about personal use, of course, because you're right that people have gone back to driving, and there's a lot more vehicles back on the road again.
So how have you got, talking about that then, how have you guys managed to control your grey fleet during this pandemic?
Good question. The grey fleet cars, everyone, it's an umbrella message that everyone must sanitise their vehicle, look after it, you know, clean the process. But those quality control measures aren't as robust as they are the fleet. But again, a lot of the grey fleet drivers, which is minimal in the council fleet, because we made a conscious effort a number of years ago to change how they drove. So that remaining number of vehicles, they have to sanitise, and the equipment's all there, it's all to be used, but there's no control measure in place for that.
Yeah, we've had one final question. We've had another question from the audience. Graham, this is for you. Have you noticed a change in driver behaviours around speeding from a COVID perspective?
Well, so again, to be frank, the speeding when the roads were quiet, when at the beginning of it, that we experienced an uplift in speeding fines. But we sent a message out again to drivers, because we do regular toolbox talks regarding speeding constantly. But we did notice that when guys were on a road that was quiet, with the volume of traffic jumping off, yes, we did see an uplift, but we were onto that immediately. And all our vehicles are controlled at 56 mile an hour, but that doesn't help in a 30 mile zone when someone's doing 37 and 38.
That's a great answer. And thanks for your time. Unfortunately, we've now run out of time. Thank you very much, guys, for the Q&A session. Graham, fantastic presentation at the start of this session as well. Thanks very much. You're really insightful. It's great to witness a fleet manager at the top of their game. So just signing off. So thanks very much, Dean. Thanks very much, Graham. And goodbye, the audience. Thanks very much.
Bye. Bye.